Hi, here you can see a default instance of the 89600 VSA vector signal analysis software. This is what the software looks like when you pull it up and you're not connected to any instrument, but rather it's just in its default state, and you can obviously browse around, but it's showing a simulated measurement of some two tones, and you can see the overall spectrum and mean time of the simulated data. For this example, we're going to go into what we like to call the BHQ option, or that's for radar pulse analysis. But to have actually a reasonable signal of interest, we're going to recall a recording. So we're going to select File, Recall, Recall Recording. And in this case, we're going to select a default recording that we previously made. So after you recall the recording, you can select Play. And we can see some things of interest, but obviously our scales aren't set correctly, and we can see some time effects here, and again, that's not set correctly as well. But we know there's some things of interest, and there's some things we could do manually, but most importantly, we want to dive right into analyzing these pulses using that deep dive pulse analysis option. So what we can do is we can select File, Recall, and we can recall a setup. And this is going to direct us to the setup file that we're using for this example today. Now, this setup file is going to bring up the default windows of our analysis software, showing a lot of different things. And I'm just going to pause the measurement for a moment here to explain what we have on the screen. For our upper left trace, we see the overall spectrum of the capture. And we'll talk about how we set up that when we first made this recording in just a moment. And then on the right-hand side, we can see our acquisition time. So this shows you basically amplitude versus time of the pulses that we're acquiring. Also beneath that, we have amplitude measure time, and we'll distinguish what the differences are between these, as well as FM measure time. And so this is basically what kind of FM or frequency modulation characteristics are happening over time. And we can see that all these are correlated with the number of pulses that we capture. You can see pulse 9, pulse 9, and pulse 9. So you get a lot of correlation between all the traces. But more importantly, a lot of the power of this particular measurement option is the pulse summary and the pulse table. In the pulse summary, we could see that it's going to display the number of pulses we captured, 19, and this correlates with the number of pulses in the acquisition time, as well as the other traces here, as well as things like average power, peak power, detection threshold, and so on. So really high-level characteristics of the overall measurement that we're making. More importantly is the pulse table itself. The pulse table gives you a pulse-by-pulse description of everything that we captured. So we can see here for pulse 1, we can see its modulation type, its modulation depth, as well as amplitude information, timing information, and so on and so forth. And this goes on for quite a bit. And we'll dive into this deeper as we go along in this video series. So this is just a quick overview of some of the default traces you'll see in this mode. Now, how can you change traces? Well, you can change traces by selecting any particular trace by just clicking on it, and then selecting this little down arrow. And this lets you change, it could be things from trace type. In this case, these are all the different spectrum traces that we can look at. We can look at amplitude-related traces. In this case, on channel 1, we can look at amplitude error time or measurement time, reference time, and so on. But we can also look at phase traces. So again, error time, measure time, and so on and so forth. We can look at FM traces that you can see here, again, along the same lines. We have a lot of different results tables as well. So things like cumulative results table, cumulative statistics, current stats, DMOD bits, the overall summary, the pulse table, as well as the train search table, which we'll get to in a different video. There's a lot of different trend line capabilities, statistical analysis, as well as histograms that you can see here. On top of that, we have different math traces that allows user-defined math functions. We can graph different things, as well as show some marker traces. So we're going to stick with the current trace layout here, but talk a little bit more about how we set up this measurement to get to here. So whenever you're trying to set up a measurement in VSA in general, and especially in terms of one of the applications you're using, you want to direct yourself towards this measurement setup window. Here you can see we could set up different parameters regarding frequency or resolution bandwidth or time. So let's just click on one of those to see what we see first. So here for frequency, under the mesh setup window, we can set a center frequency as well as a span. So we can see that with a center of 1 gigahertz, which is reflected on our spectrum trace as well, and a span of 160 megahertz, this is telling us what the overall center frequency and the frequency bandwidth that we're capturing either from a simulated data environment or from an actual instrument recording. So for example, this could have been made from a spectrum analyzer from Keysight, maybe our PXA or a UXA, with 160 megahertz of span setting centered at 1 gigahertz. And there's a few other things we can change, things like resolution bandwidth in terms of frequency points, windowing type, etc., as well as the time. Now, you'll see that a lot of these are grayed out. And this is specifically because if you go back to mesh setup and into the measurement type, we are in a specific mode. We are in our radar analysis mode, and that allows us to set things up specifically towards pulse measurements. So again, under mesh setup, we're going into pulse properties. So pulse properties comes up here, and you get a really nice, concise dialog that allows you to set things up very easily. So in this case, after we set up our center frequency and span, we can set up what our different thresholds are to capture pulses. In this case, we want to set up a threshold of minus 1 dB, and this is relative to the top level of pulses that we capture in general. We could also change this as an absolute number, and we might change this to, say, minus 10 dBm. So in this case, we're going to capture all pulses that are above minus 10 dBm. We can add some hysteresis on here, as well as ignore some timing dropouts if you have a very bursty signal, as well as set minimum pulse widths. We're going to turn that off for now, as well as set maximum pulse widths. So here, since we changed the measurement setting, we'll just take a single acquisition. We could see that since we made a change to our overall detection setting, we're not capturing any more pulses in our measurement time or FM time, but we can see overall we're still capturing the spectrum and the acquisition time. So this means we're actually looking at data, but the overall BHQ pulse analysis application isn't doing that automatic measuring. And that's because our threshold is too high. So what we want to do is say maybe move this down to, let's try minus 25 dBm or say minus 30 dBm. And we can see that's still a little too high. So the best way to go is still leave it back to what we had before, and we should be able to get our measurements back. And you can see here, there it goes. So sometimes, depending what you know you're looking for or what you're unsure of looking for, I'd say start with the default settings, and you'll be able to quickly make measurements and then fine-tune it from there. Now, let's go to the time tab. So this time tab is probably one of the most important tabs in the sense that you can choose how long you want to acquire for. So you can see here we're set to 440 microseconds. And if we pause the measurement once again, you see that this overall acquisition time is about 440 microseconds. And that's really important because it's going to basically dictate how much not only can you see on the display, but how much you could potentially measure at any given time. So if we go back to the time tab, we can also set things like sample rate. So if you're a little bit more sample rate inclined rather than measurement span, thinking about the speed of rise times and fall times, you can directly change the sample rate of your measurement if you'd like. But in the same breath, we still display what the equivalent span of the measurement would be. So you can think about it in frequency domain at the same time. This maximum pulse count is a really interesting feature as well. If we check that, it's already defaulted to 19 because we have 19 pulses here. But if we change this to, say, 10, what we see is that something changed. In our acquisition time, we still see the full trace data. But for the measure time, you see that we, instead of showing all 19 like we did before, we're only showing 10. And that's represented by these 10 pulses being highlighted, and then functionally a zoomed in copy of that in the measurement time of only being 10. Again, if we change this to say maybe 5, we functionally zoom in from the overall acquisition time, which is still 440 microseconds, but now we're only being a little bit more careful in everything we specifically analyze by the measurement time trace, both in amplitude measurement time and FM measurement time. So let's set this back out to our 19 so we get the full acquisition. And you can see you can change the relative values, whether it's to the first pulse or to the trigger, or relative or absolute values, so on and so forth. Now, this really helps in the sense that you can really fine-tune a specific event or a particular pulse of interest if you want to analyze it further. Now, stepping down the line here, we have the Regions tab. Now, the Regions tab is a little set and forget to a certain degree, but it really helps define how the measurements are being made in the sense that for a detection threshold or a measurement threshold, if we're going to measure rise time, we're going to measure the 10% on the lower end and 70% at the upper end. You could change this to 80-20 or 90-10 or whatever parameters you like or the specification dictates for your particular measurement. Similarly with fall time or pulse width, you could set your pulse width to be 90% of the pulse width or maybe 50% or just the center 20%. There's a lot of different domains you could look at in terms of voltage or power. You could look at calculation method, whether it's mode, median, or mean, and so on. And the analysis regions are just the same as well. How do you want to estimate droop? What's your ripple analysis width of the pulse itself? How do you want to calculate your frequency and phase analysis in terms of percentage of the pulse top or percentage of the chirp region for, say, a triangular FM or for the percentage of chips if you have a Barker-coded pulse? So all these things will functionally change how we represent the data, but it's all user-editable depending on what's useful for your particular measurement or do you have a specification called out in a particular measurement guide. Let's go into showing a little bit more of what we can do in the advanced measurement. And advanced is interesting because this is where we can remove some things like slopes or second order effects or the average or the mean with regards to trends or histograms or cumulative tables. And cumulative tables will make more sense in just a moment, but this just allows you a little bit more advanced fine-tuning display and measurement capability depending on what you want to look at. So with that, since we're pretty happy with our measurement setup, let's go back to the live measurement here and look at a few different things. Let's look at our pulse table a little bit more. And in VSA, one of the beauties is you can resize all these traces however you'd like and move them around. So now that we can see our pulse table in more entirety, and we see that there's a lot of different values here, maybe we're not interested in all these values. Let's just get down to the data that we're really interested in. So I'm going to right-click, and I can select column visibility. And this allows a user to really look at and say, I want to look at the modulation on the pulses, but I don't need to know too much else. So I'm just going to uncheck that for now. I just want to look at the top level. I don't care about droop. I don't care about overshoot or ripple at the moment. But let's look at pulse width as well as PRI. And then frequency, let's just look at the average. Same for the phase. And we're not concerned about best fit FM at the moment. So let's click OK. So what happens now is we greatly reduce all the fields that were previously displayed to just the ones that we're interested in. So now we can see pulse 1 through 19, which again is correlated to 1 through 19, our acquisition and measurement time traces. We see the reported modulation type, the amplitude or the top level of each pulse. We see the pulse width of each, and we can see that that changes over time. We see the pulse repetition interval, or the PRI, the duty cycle, the frequency, and we can see that changes over time, and then lastly, the phase of each of those. Now, we have a lot of powerful data. We have trace data, and we have parametric data, but what's even more interesting in this particular tool is that we can look at things statistically. So let's change this trace here and go to, say, a histogram. And We saw in our pulse table that some things change between PRI and frequency. So let's set a histogram to PRI. And now we can right click and auto scale this, and we can see very quickly that based on this histogram, and even if we hit start, this histogram is going to change over time. We see that there's about five distinct PRIs. So let's pause it for a moment, and we're going to select our marker here, and we're going to put a marker on this histogram. And here we can see that this marker is at 9.6755 microseconds. So we have a pretty good idea that there's quite a few pulses in this train or in our measurement that have that PRI. And then some lower ones are about 20 microseconds, 30 microseconds, a few more at 40 microseconds, and then a few more at about 49 and a half or close to 50 microseconds. So quite quickly, you can use these histogram tools, not only for PRI, but we can also look at phase, which we saw some changes. You can quickly understand what's happening within the overall acquisition itself from a histogram point of view to understand statistically, is this signal of interest, is it doing what I expect, as well as make measurements on these traces. Something else that we want to take a quick look at as well is maybe the trend lines. So let's look at trend line at the frequency, because we saw some changes there. So we'll find frequency in our trend line. Here's frequency mean, and we're going to hit play, and we're going to scale this. So I'm going to hit auto scale. So instead of a histogram layout, we could see our trend line changing quite quickly over time, but there's definitely a noticeable pattern. So something that we can do is we can take our marker and we can measure a frequency at a particular time and look at what type, what frequency it is and at what sample it is. So this presents a pretty interesting case to look at frequency over time to see what kind of patterns present themselves. Lastly, something of interest is, say, the cumulative results table. And this is a really powerful table in the sense that what we can do is if we just, say, take a single measurement, the pulse table and the cumulative results table end up being virtually the same. And you can see this here quite quickly. What's of value for the cumulative results table is that if we set up a repetitive measurement, we'll be able to not only capture the pulse table, which updates for every initial acquisition, but we can append all those acquisitions after one another. So by doing that, I let this measurement run for a few seconds. I'm going to hit pause, but now, as you can see, I have thousands of pulses in this cumulative results table as compared to